The Battle of Bucico or Busico, fought on 27 September 1810 during the Peninsular War in the Portuguese mountain range of Serra do Bucico, resulted in the defeat of French forces by Lord Wellington's Anglo-Portuguese army. Having occupied the heights of Busico Long Ridge located at 40 degrees 20 minutes 40 seconds north, 8 degrees 20 minutes 15 seconds west, with 25,000 British and the same number of Portuguese, Wellington was attacked 5 times successively by 65,000 French under Marshal André Masséna. Masséna was uncertain as to the disposition and strength of the opposing forces because Wellington deployed him on the reverse slope of the ridge, where they could neither be easily seen nor easily softened up with artillery. The actual assaults were delivered by the corps of Marshal Michel Ney and General of Division Jean Renier, but after much fierce fighting they failed to dislodge the Allied forces and were driven off after having lost 4,500 men against 1,250 Anglo-Portuguese casualties. Background. Operations in 1810, Emperor Napoleon I ordered Masséna to drive the British from Portugal. Accordingly, the French marshal began the siege of Ciudad Rodrigo in April. The Spanish garrison held out until the 9th of July when the fortress fell. The Battle of the Coa was fought soon after. The siege of Almeida ended suddenly with a massive explosion of the fortress magazine on the 26th of August. With all obstacles cleared from their path, the French could march on Lisbon in strength. It was important to delay the French until the defences being built around Lisbon, the lines of Torres Vedras, could be completed, using selective demolition of bridges and roads. Viscount Wellington restricted the choice of routes the French could use and slowed the advance of the French troops. At the end of September, they met Wellington's army drawn up on the ridge of Busico. The ridge, which at its highest rises to 549 meters in height, lies at right angles to the main road to Coimbra and thence to Lisbon, providing one of the few and certainly the best defensive position on the French route of march. Allied organization Wellington had brought together 6 British infantry divisions. The light under Brigadier General Robert Crawford, the first led by Major General Brent Spencer, the second commanded by M.G. Rowland Hill, the third under M.G. Thomas Picton, with attached Portuguese Brigade, the fourth led by M.G. Lowry Cole, with attached Portuguese Brigade, the fifth under M.G. James Leith, with attached Portuguese Brigade. In addition, the newly retrained Portuguese Army supplied a 2-brigade Portuguese Infantry Division under M.G. John Hamilton, and 3 independent Portuguese brigades led by B.G. Dennis Pack, B.G. Alexander Campbell and B.G. John Coleman, B.G. George de Grey, B.G. John Slade, B.G. George Anson and B.G. Henry Fane led 4 British cavalry brigades, plus 4 regiments of Portuguese cavalry. In batteries of 6 guns apiece, there were 6 British, 2 King's German Legion and 5 Portuguese batteries under B.G. Edward Howorth. The Anglo-Portuguese army numbered 50,000, with 50% Portuguese troops. French organization Masséna's army of 60,000 included the 2nd Corps under Renier, the 6th Corps led by Ney, the 8th Corps under M.G. Jean Andoche Junot and a cavalry reserve led by M.G. Louis Pierre, Count Montbrun, the divisions of M.G. Pierre-Hugues Victoire Merle and M.G. Étienne Hudelet de Bire made up Renier's corps. Ney's corps had 3 divisions under M.G.'s Jean Marchand, Julien Mermet and Louis Loison. Junot had the divisions of M.G. Bertrand Plausel and M.G. Jean-Baptiste Solignac. Each French corps contained the standard brigade of light cavalry. General of Brigade Jean-Baptiste Ibielli-Acute, Masséna's artillery chief, commanded 112 guns. Plans Wellington posted his army along the crest of Busico Ridge, facing east, to improve his lateral communications. He had previously ordered his 4 officers from the Royal Corps of Engineers to cut a road that ran the length of the ridge on the reverse slope. Cole held the left flank. Next came Crawford, Spencer, Picton and Leith. Hill held the right flank with Hamilton's men attached. Massena, believing he easily outnumbered the British and goaded by Ney and other officers to attack the British position rather than go around it, ordered a reconnaissance of the steep ridge. Very few of Wellington's troops were visible, as they remained on the reverse slope and were ordered not to light cooking fires. The French general planned to send Reynier at the centre of the ridge, which he believed to be the British right flank. Once the Second Corps attack showed some signs of success, Massena would launch Ney's corps at the British along the main road. The 8th Corps stood behind the 6th Corps in reserve. While Ney announced that he was ready to attack and conquer, Reynier suddenly had second thoughts, predicting his attack would be beaten. Battle. Second Corps attack. Reynier's troops struck in the early morning mist. Hewlett sent his leading brigade straight up the slope in a formation one company wide and 8 battalions deep. When the leading regiment reached the top of the ridge, they found themselves facing the 74th Foot and 2 Portuguese battalions in line, plus 12 cannon. The French tried to change formation from column into a line. Pellet says, the column began to deploy as if it an exercise, but the Allies brought intense musketry to bear. Soon, the French infantrymen were thrown into confusion. However, they clung to a precarious toehold on the ridge. Several hundred yards to the north, Merle's division thrust up the ridge in a similar formation. Picton hurriedly massed his defenders by utilizing the ridgetop road, met at the crest by the 88th Foot and the 45th Foot and 2 Portuguese battalions in a concave line. The French tried unsuccessfully to deploy into line. Crushed by converging fire, the French fled down the slope. Merle was wounded while General of Brigade Jean-François Grandgorge fell mortally wounded. Wellington rode up to Colonel Alexander Wallace of the 88th and remarked, "Wallace, I have never witnessed a more gallant charge," seeing Hewlett's 2nd Brigade standing immobile at the foot of the ridge. Reynier rode up to B.G. Maximilien Foy and demanded an immediate attack. With the Allies out of position after defeating the first two attacks, Foy hit a weak spot in their defences. Fortuitously, the French struck the least prepared unit in the Allied army, a Portuguese militia unit, and routed it. But the morning mist cleared, revealing no enemies in front of the British right flank. Wellington had already ordered Leith to shift his men to the north to assist Picton. Before Foy's men could consolidate their gain, they were attacked by the 9th Foot and 38th Foot of Leith and some of Picton's men. The French were swept off the ridge and Foy wounded. After seeing this rout, Hewlett's other brigade withdrew to the base of the ridge. 6th Corps attack. Hearing gunfire, Ney assumed Reynier's men were enjoying success and ordered an attack. In this sector, the main highway climbed a long spur past the hamlets of Mora and Sula to reach the crest at the convent of Barsico. Against a very heavy British skirmish line, Loison's division fought its way forward. Near the crest, 1,800 men of the 43rd and 52nd Infantry Regiments lay down waiting. As Loison's leading brigade approached the convent grounds, the two British units stood up, fired a terrific volley at point-blank range and charged with the bayonet. The French brigade collapsed and fled, leaving B.G. Edouard Simon, their commander, wounded and a prisoner. A short time later and slightly further south, Loison's 2nd Brigade under B.G. Claude François Ferry ran into a close-range fire from two batteries plus Anglo-Portuguese musketry. This unit was also routed. A final thrust by B.G. Antoine Louis Popon de Maucun's brigade of Marchand's division met defeat when it ran into Denis Pack's Portuguese brigade. The two sides occupied the rest of the day in vigorous skirmishing, but the French did not try to attack in force again. Aftermath. The French suffered 522 dead, 3,612 wounded, and 364 captured. The Allied losses numbered 200 dead, 1,001 wounded, and 51 missing. The British and Portuguese each lost exactly 626 men. Massena now realized the size of Wellington's forces and the strength of the defensive position, so that afternoon ordered troops to move off to the right on a hazardous but skillful move to outflank the position and reach another road to the north just ahead of a Portuguese corps that had been sent there to defend it. Wellington, after spending the night in the convent, and finding his position turned, resumed the leisurely retreat of his army towards the still being constructed lines of Torres Vedras. He reached these in good order by the 10th of October. Continuing to advance, Massena had left his sick and wounded troops at Coimbra, where a few days later, they fell into the hands of the Portuguese. This was the first major battle of the Peninsular War in which units of the reconstituted Portuguese army fought, where the Portuguese troops played a prominent part and the victory served as a great morale boost to the inexperienced troops. After probing the lines in the Battle of Sobral on 14 October, Massena found them too strong to attack and withdrew into winter quarters. Deprived of food for his men and harried by Anglo-Portuguese hit-and-run tactics, he lost a further 25,000 men captured or dead from starvation or sickness before he retreated into Spain early in 1811. This finally freed Portugal from French occupation except for the fortress of Almeida, near the frontier. During the retreat, several actions were fought, including the Battle of Sabugal. In fiction, Sharpe's Escape by Bernard Cornwell covers the Battle of Busaco.